All right. Okay, well, very good. So let's go ahead and get started for our second session. Let me share with you a few testimonies, just some things that have happened in my life that began to make this transition. So I referred to it a little bit that I began to feel like I should be allowing Jesus to heal the sick through me. Well, at that time I had actually been a church planting pastor that had, our church, we morphed it. Because I'm more of a missionary at heart than I am a clergyman, if that makes sense. And so we just sort of morphed things into a network of home churches. I went into bivocational ministry, so I began working in the business world as in a manufacturing consulting firm. And after several years of this, I actually began to know a lot of their consulting processes very well. And was coming back from a client's one day, and I'm praying in tongues, and I'm saying, God, if I feel like the problems are here. I feel like there's a yes in my spirit that, yes, Jesus, you'll heal the sick through me today. But the problem is all these doubts and questions. What about Timothy's stomach? And what about my wife, you know, and all the times we prayed? And what about this? And what about that? And he was like, I got all these objections of, biblically, stuff I've been taught, and then, you know, experientially, things that didn't line up. And then all of a sudden, God opens things up and says, it's in the name. And I knew what that meant. When Jesus was transitioning from physically being with his disciples to being present with them by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit, he began speaking about, until now, you've not asked for anything in my name. You've never thought that you could ask for son stuff. But now, if you want to talk to God, you don't talk to God like I'm an intermediary. You step into my relationship with the Father and you speak to Him like I would. Because you take on my name, and everything that you see in my name, that's yours. So if you see it in my name, but you don't have it, ask for it. That it might be yours, that your joy might be made complete. Amen? How many of you know there's a lot of things that we see in Jesus that some people just don't even think to ask? Lord, raise the dead through me. Lord, open deaf ears. Open blind eyes through me. Lord, start a movement of your kingdom through me. Set captives free wherever I go. Let people be touched by my very shadow. They brush up against me, and all of a sudden they get healed. Lord, that you did that. I want to carry that, because that's who we carry. But we need to believe for it. The Holy Spirit flows through our faith. Amen? As we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, in His name. God got me over it like that. I knew it was in the name. So you know what? I'm driving back, and I got to go to the bathroom. So I pull off at a stop, and there's a young lady there who's got a knee brace on, and she's standing in crutches in front of the gas station counter. And I started to walk up towards her, and I walked right past her to go into the restroom. And then chickened out. And then I said, okay, Lord, if she's still there when I come out, then I'll pray for her, right? So I'm sharing with you my slow start. So some of you guys might be at that slow start spot. So I want you guys to know when I start sharing really cool stories, that's where I started too, right? So then I come out, man, she's still there. That girl is slow, you know? Darn! So then I walked towards her, and I was like, oh, that's going to be awkward. So I just walked out of the store, and I'm sitting in my car, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, Lord, I told you I'd do it, and I'm whatever. And here she comes, crutching her way out the store. So I rolled down my window, and she's getting in the car right next to me. And I said, hey, what happened to your leg? And she started telling me about an ACL or an MCL or something with an L, you know, and she was playing volleyball or something like that. I don't remember. I was just trying to make conversation. And I said, hey, could I pray for you to be healed? And she said, sure. So I got out of the car, and by now she's sitting. She's a teenage girl, right? She's not the driver even, you know, and I'm sure her parents are thinking, you know, child predator on the loose, You know, I don't know what they're thinking, you know. And so she's sitting there. I said, just hold still really quick. And I said, in Jesus' name, knee be healed. And then I jumped in my car, shut the door, and drove up. You know, I didn't even check or nothing, man. I was just trying to get up my gumption to pray for this girl. Then our home meeting, our home church meetings, they come together. And I just had to humble myself and say, look, God's really gotten a hold of me, and I don't know how to explain this. I'm not asking any of you to believe what I believe. But I just want to let you know, I really believe that God wants you well. And there's some of you that have been hurting for so long. And I've never offered to pray for your healing. The truth was, because me, myself, and I didn't really have a whole lot of belief that anything was really going to happen, because I've not had any success in this. But God's done something in my heart, and I just want to let you know, I will pray for you until you're healed. I will minister to you, and I'm not great at it. I just believe Jesus is. And not only will I pray for you, I'll pray for anybody else. I just believe it's part of the gospel, right? That God has showed up on our planet to bring us back right, set us right, in right relationship with Him, to make us right again within ourselves, to set us free from everything that hell put in us. Lies, depression, pain, rejection, sin. Amen? And to put heaven inside of us. You and I were created to be image bearers of God. We are created like water bottles for God, so He could pour Himself in, so that when people squeeze us, that He comes out. When people come in contact with us, that they experience life-giving water. Amen? Well, those were my slow starts. And then I started going out to a college campus. Some, I was like, man, and along the way, it's funny, I started moving with this, and then I came across John G. Lake Ministries, Curry's teaching, and it really helped me in the area of healing. There were some questions I still had. I still couldn't figure out Timothy's stomach, you know? At that point, I had no answer for it. But I figured out Jesus. I was like, healing looks like Jesus. He has all authority. He healed all that were brought to Him. Amen? He never failed. He never said, I can't get you healed because you just won't repent. You know, you got hidden sin and bitterness in your heart. You know, He didn't go around blaming people and leaving people sitting there, did He? He was able to get people healed by His own authority, His own faith, His own power. When people believed for their own healing, He would commend that, wouldn't He? He'd say, your faith got you this. He would let them know, you believe the right thing. He would commend them. But I'll tell you what, it wasn't hit or miss. How many of you know that there had been some people like, I don't know if this is going to work or not. Why'd they drag me out here, man? You know, I mean, you know there's got to be people that are going to Jesus like that. There's people that I'm sure didn't even know, who is this man that you just let into my room? And all of a sudden, hey, you know. Remember the guy? They said, tell us about this man that healed you. Well, I can't tell you much. All I know is that I was blind and now I see. Well, this man is a sinner. If he's a sinner or not, I don't even know. But what I do know, I couldn't see before. Now I can see. And then later, Jesus found him. Amen? How many of you know that Jesus healed by His own authority, by His own power? This guy wasn't sitting around believing for Messiah to touch him. Wasn't happening. So that's a good thing. I'm not trying to discourage people for believing God for your healing or somebody else's. I'm trying to let you know that if you have faith in Jesus Christ, that that's enough to get the job done for other people. That's good, isn't it? Now, sometimes when I say things like this, there are people who've been hurting for some time, and you know, they're like, oh, I just got to have this, and I don't know why. You know, it's kind of been rolling around in your brain for a long time, you know. And I want to let you know, don't let these, what I'm teaching, be swallowed up with, yeah, but well, what about me, and will I have believed, and what, you know what, just forget about your circumstances as best you can. We're going to have some ministry time tonight, okay, before you go, all right? Don't want anybody going home hurting. Don't want anybody to be confused. What I want you to understand is you need to let Jesus and the truth of the gospel speak louder than your circumstances. Amen? Everybody's got circumstances. Everybody. And we used to think that our circumstances were somehow telling us something about how God felt about us. Or about our own spirituality. How many of you know sometimes your circumstances are not bad because there's something wrong with you or the way God feels about you? There's this person called a thief. Jesus said the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And you've been told, well, you must have done something to give him a right or an open door. And so now all of a sudden you're responsible for everything that the devil does. How many of you know I can drive away from my house and done everything I could to lock it up nice and safe, but thieves go where they know they don't have any rights. They just want to steal stuff. They take stuff they know doesn't belong to them that they've got no right to. Amen? So I'm here to bring the gospel that healing is good news. It's not something for you to beat yourself up about if you've got sickness or disease or you tried to minister to somebody and they did not get healed. You don't beat yourself up about that. Sometimes you got to forget what lies behind. Reach forward to what lies ahead. Amen? Don't let the devil beat you up over the past. And don't let him cut you off from what's your rightful inheritance for your future. Amen? Amen. Become a product of the truth of God and not the circumstances that the enemy's brought in your life. Amen? So that's good news. So I started going regularly up to the college that was close to my house when I could on my lunch hours. And I still hadn't developed a whole lot of tact, knowledge, or boldness to be able to talk to people in public. So I figured what I would do is I found this bench in a fairly populated place in the student union, and I found this way that I could sit on the corner of the bench and open up my book bag and look like I was fidgeting. I looked down in the book bag, and I was pretty harmless, and then people would come sit on the other side of the bench. So then, and when they did, I could start talking to them and say, hey, how's your day going? And that kind of thing. That was my strategy. I was kind of like fishing, you know. I'd put the little worm on the hook, sit on my bench, and just watch the bobber and wait for somebody to come sit on the other side. And then I'd start a conversation. Well, they'd invariably come and sit, and I just had some great conversations, saw some people had come to know Jesus, saw some people really get touched by God. One in particular was really significant. There was one guy came and sat. I tried to strike up a conversation. It was going nowhere. I mean, he just did not want to talk to me, right? So finally, I just said, well, you must need a miracle. What is it? You know, I was trying to start up conversations about, you know, the weather, or, you know, school or something he might be interested in. He just, just nowhere with those conversations. So finally, I just said, you must need a miracle. What is it? And he looked at me like, what? And I said, yeah, man. I said, look, I'm not even a student. I come here on my lunch hour sometimes. And every time I come out here, I say, God, put me near people who need a miracle in their life. You could have been anywhere on this campus, but you came and sat on my bench. You must need a miracle. And he goes, well, how do you even know there's a God? And he wanted to start trying to debate, you know, all this kind of stuff. I said, listen, I didn't ask you what you believe, whether you've been naughty, whether you've been nice. I'm not trying to argue with you. If God's real, you know, what miracle do you need in your life? And he said, if God's real, I'm mad at him. And I said, really? What did God do to you? See, I don't believe that God's very insecure, and I didn't think that God really had done anything wrong. I wanted to find out what was in this guy's heart. You understand? I don't have to argue for God. I need to show him God. Amen? How many of you know that God's around a lot of people that don't like him very much on this planet? All right? And he's still with them with a heart wide open. Now, he said, well, I've been in chronic pain since I've been 12 years old. I said, really? And he goes, I said, yeah. And I said, does it hurt now? He goes, it always hurts. And I said, really? So where does it hurt? He goes, it hurts all over. I said, where does it hurt now? You know, he wasn't giving me nothing, you know. And he said, it always hurts in my legs. And I said, listen, I'm going to pray for you and you're going to see how much God loves you. He goes, phew. All right, so that's how much faith this guy's in. Mm-hmm. Right? So I get down on my knees in front of him and start to reach my hands out towards him. And as soon as I do, he goes, ow, dude, that hurts. I hadn't even touched him yet. You know, like when I was riding in the pickup truck with my dad, he grabbed my... You ever see a cow eat corn? He goes, oh, dad! You know, it wasn't like that. You know, I didn't touch him. And so I put my hands out towards him and I realized what was going on is that whatever was hurting him saw my hands coming. Right? And wanted to stop me from ever putting my hands. So they dug in. Right? And so I said, in Jesus' name, everything causing him pain, go now. Come out of him. And he goes like this. And he startled a little bit. And I said, get up, move around. And he moved around. And he's looking. I said, it's gone, isn't it? And he's looking, you know, he's looking for his pain. He was like, where'd it go? You know, and he had a trench coat on. He reached into his trench coat and he pulls out a prescription pill or a prescription bottle. He said, could be these. I said, did you take one of those when I prayed for you? He's confused now, you know. And I said, look, man, let's walk for a little bit. So we walked for a little bit. And I said, I bet what happened was this. You probably believed in God until you started having this pain. And when you started having this pain, you started thinking, what did I do to deserve this? Did I do something wrong? So you started confessing just about everything you could think of. And nothing changed. And then you started thinking, well, if God's real, he either doesn't care or he's just not real. And so, because guess what? Jesus said this, that the thief comes to steal, to kill, to destroy, but I've come that they might have life. Amen? And you had the enemy come into your life at that point, started to steal your peace, started to steal your health, started to destroy your body. And he's also called the slanderer, the accuser. So he started accusing you. What did you do wrong? Right? He started speaking to you through that situation. You must have done something wrong. If God really loved you, right, he accused your worth. You're worthless, right? You start defining yourself by your circumstances. And then he started slandering God, didn't he? God doesn't listen. God doesn't care. God can't help you. He doesn't want to help you. So he's doing all this stuff through what he's doing in your body. I want to let you know that if you're here, that your circumstances and your life experience is a terrible place for you to get your understanding of how God feels about you. The only place that you can get the right understanding about how God feels about you is look at the cross. Romans 5 verse 8 says this, but God demonstrates his love towards us in this, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen? Before you ever cared a lick about doing anything what God said, you're worth dying for. Mm-hmm. You are worth dying for. It's not a one-way street. God did everything for you. He's not trying to get something out of you. He's trying to, except for hell, trying to get hell out of you so he could put his love inside of you. His Spirit, His power, His grace. Amen? Well, how many of you know Jesus healed a lot of people, but a lot of those people were just interested in getting healed. They didn't want a relationship. You know, He healed 10 lepers. How many of them came back? One, right? So this is not a quick fix, easy church growth situation sort of message. This is about becoming kingdom agents, about walking as sons, about learning how to walk in the fullness of God. And you will make a tremendous impact. But there's times where people will take everything that you want and everything that God wants to give them, and you may never see them again. And that's not time for you to get bitter and like, man, this was just a worm on a hook. What I really wanted was for them to get back over. You know, sometimes it doesn't work that way. Jesus had how many come back? One. I hardly ever have people come back. But after this guy, I told him, I said, hey, I've got plenty to do, but here's my business card. If you'd ever like to talk again, I'd be happy to make some more time for you, okay? You know, it's like I'm offering more of me, you know? Sometimes people feel it like you're just trying to get me to come to your church kind of thing. This is not a gimmicky sort of thing. This is a way to demonstrate the love of God. And I'm not saying church is not important. What I'm saying is that what's important is for people to really feel that you love them and don't just have some agenda to use them. That's what they felt a lot. Amen? So sometimes I don't offer people, you know, my contact information. But a lot of times I'll do, but I'll do it in a way that it feels like I'm offering more of myself, not trying to get something from them. Do you understand? And so this guy, he actually called me. I was pretty shocked. He called me and he said, dude, you fixed it. And I said, that wasn't me, man. It was Jesus. He said, no, you don't understand. I've had lupus since I've been 12 years old. And I said, I don't care what you call the thing. Jesus' name is higher. And he goes, listen, I've been either too doped up on painkillers to do anything, or I've been in too much pain to do anything. And I've been waiting for this pain to come back. And he said, I haven't taken any painkillers. I haven't had a bit of withdrawals from my pain medication, and I haven't had any pain. I said, I'm fixed. You fixed it. And I said, I didn't fix it. It was Jesus. And you know what the last thing he said? He said, I feel like I got my life back.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. I mean, that's the gospel. That's part of the gospel. Amen. That God came to restore us, to buy us back, to bring us back, to give people life. To set people free from the work of the thief who's stealing, killing, destroying. Amen? We don't want that. God doesn't want that. He's not for that. So, let's kind of look at a few things that oftentimes confuse people. A lot of times people are told, and I believe this, is that the reason Jesus can heal the sick is because He's God. I believe Jesus is God. I believe He's also man. Amen? He is the eternal Son who's forever been in the presence of the Father, fully one with the Father and Father, Son, and Spirit, one divine being. Mm-hmm. We are one person to beings. God is a three-personed being, one being. Amen? But He's a three-personed being. The Father has a relationship with the Son. In the Spirit. They share one Spirit. Amen? The Father has a self-image. It's the Son. And the Son receives the Father and images forth back the Father. They just love each other. They've been doing this for a long time. And they said, let's go public. Let's make this visible. Amen? Let's make image bearers. People who can contain us and display us in the visible world. That's why you and I were created empty. Your heart was made to contain love. Your mind shouldn't be empty. But how many of you know that it doesn't come in preloaded? Amen? We were meant, our minds, to contain the mind and the truth and the wisdom of God. You were made to enjoy love, fellowship, wisdom, and to put that on display. How many of you know that you put on display what's in you, don't you? Mm-hmm. With your words, with your attitudes, with your actions. Man, you put it on display. And how many of you know that most of the time we intuitively know if God were real, people would be different, right? We look at people and we say, if God's like that, I don't want anything to do with them, right? We look at people. Why? Because people should be showing us what God's like. Especially those that claim to know Him. Amen? Even the atheist intuitively knows that. If God was real, the church wouldn't be so ugly. Right? How many of you know it was the religious people that put Jesus on the cross? Amen? Mm-hmm. You understand that? So that's kind of what we got to deal with. There's a difference. And so when you and I are trying to pull off religion by our own efforts, it doesn't work so well. But when we learn that we get to participate in a relationship and to let that Spirit inhabit us and flow out of us, and that same Spirit heals bodies, raised Christ from the dead, dwells in us. Man, that's amazing. So listen, here's how I explain this. Jesus wasn't Jesus before he was conceived and born in the womb of Mary, right? He didn't have a human life. He had only a divine life, the Son of God that was eternal. And the Father and the Son, they're loving one another. And then, guess what? The Son joins the human race, doesn't he? And that relationship that was going on invisibly, now the Father relates to the Son through the humanity of Jesus Christ. Amen? And the Son relates to the Father through His humanity. Now, here's the cool thing about it. You and I were created to be containers of the image of God. Jesus, as a man, is able to display what God is like, because that's what human beings were created for in the first place. We came unhooked, right? We came unplugged from the power source. So, you know, you look at these dead light bulbs sitting on the shelf thinking, why would anybody want to buy that? It doesn't, that's not light. False advertisement, you know? Then you plug it in, it's like, oh, ooh. When it's plugged in, yeah, it was designed just right. Amen? Jesus is able to show us what God is like through His humanity. But listen, while He's living as a human being, He's not also living out of as God at the same time. He is living as a man among us. He chose to set aside. He couldn't set aside His divinity. He couldn't do that. But He could set aside the exercise of His rights, powers, and privileges as God. Think of it this way. If the President of the United States or some other glorious country decided that they're going to solve poverty in their nation, right? And they realized, man, I was born with a silver spoon in my mouth. Well, we've got to solve this poverty thing. And I'm convinced that there's no politician that knows what this is all about. So my first act as your leader is I am going to live as a homeless man for the next 3 months. Right? Now, while they're living as a homeless man for 3 months, they are both the president or king and a homeless man at the same time. Amen? Are they not? They are. But could they live as a president or a king and a homeless man at the same time? No. There's no homeless people I know that have Air Force One, Secret Service protection. They don't have, you know, they can't go raid the White House refrigerator at night. You know, they don't have these things. They have the shirt on their backs and the wits in their heads and the friends that they can make. That's about it. Amen? So that's exactly what the Son of God did. That, you know, angels would see Him and cover their eyes. They'd flap their wings. They'd cry, holy, holy, holy. He was glorious. He set aside, it says in Philippians chapter 2, that He emptied Himself. Amen? He emptied Himself to be made just like us. And He walked among us and He obeyed so that He could redeem us. That's why in Revelation, it's the angels cry out, worthy is He to receive all glory, to receive all wisdom, to receive all knowledge, to receive all power. I used to read that and think, well, if Jesus is God, I thought He already had all that stuff. He had it. He set it aside so that he could live as a man among men, but a man as God intended, a man who's plugged in, a man who's got God dwelling in him. And so Jesus said, it's not me doing it. John chapter 5, verse 19, right? The works that you see are not mine, but my Father dwelling in me does his works.
Amen.
See, it's not me doing it. It's kind of like computer screens, monitors, you know? Like back in the day when computers were first coming out, they didn't all hook up to the internet. Some of them just ran programs. They were self-contained little units. They weren't hooked up to anything except themselves. You know, you could type up your research paper, do an Excel spreadsheet. You could do some stuff like that. But internet, you know, that was just, you know, those were add-ons. Those were extras. You know, and the neat thing about that time, those PCs, they used to always lock up on this screen. You know, they stop just like this, you know. You press save or reboot, you know. You couldn't get them to do anything. So you finally just unplug everything, plug them back in, and hope for the best, you know. That's the way you and I were. We were created by God to display God, and our software's all faulty. We've got all these wrong thinking. We've got all these wrong attitudes. We've got this wrong stuff. And then Jesus comes along and you look at his monitor screen, you know, and he's got like all this stuff. He's got YouTube videos and, you know, he's got all this. Like, he's just, what is he doing? He's healing the sick. He's casting out demons. He's living in perfect love. He's forgiving people that other people wanted to stone. Amen? And you look at him and you're like, how's he doing that? Where does he get these programs from? And he says, it's not me. I'm just live streaming my Father. Right? You're seeing what's in my Father being displayed. Amen? And he said, now, good news is this. I'm going to die and rise again, and I'm going to become a Wi-Fi. And I'm going to hook you guys up so that you can live stream what's on my Father too. Because now I've downloaded everything from my Father onto me. I've become a Wi-Fi and a server. So everything you need, everything that was in me, you're going to have access to now. Amen? So now what we need to do is stop running our own programs. Stop running our own thinking. And start learning to receive to the mind of Christ. There's things that you believe about you that Jesus doesn't believe about you. You might believe you're inadequate, unworthy. I could never do this. Guess what? Jesus doesn't believe that. He doesn't. You want to know how I know? Because the Bible tells me so. It's very simple. All right? So, have I lost anybody? We going okay so far? So here's the neat thing about it. Jesus walked as a son, but he knew that the way that sons live, it wasn't something special for himself. It was something that God was, that was our destiny too. Amen? And so every time Jesus did something amazing, you would think Jesus would say, hey, just forget about it. You know, I'm just showing you who I am, trying to prove that I'm God. That's not what he ever said. He says, not me, it's my Father too. And guess what? If you believe, you'll do it too. If you have faith, you'll do it too. He was always telling them that you can do it too. You can do it too. Listen, if Jesus healing the sick was just proving he was God, why did he send the 12 out healing the sick? Prove that they were God too? He sent the 70 out. If healing the sick was just for Jesus and the 12 apostles, why did he send 70 people out healing the sick, casting out demons and raising the dead? If this was a, hey guys, it's just for us, I'm going to establish it, get the book written, and then once the book written, that's it. You know, he didn't do it that way, did it? You know, that mindset I can't find in the Scriptures. It would be really close to saying, hey, you know what, America, we only needed a military until we signed the Constitution. But once we have the Constitution, we don't need a military anymore. You get it? That's dumb, isn't it? We need the power of God. But it's the power that's in the Word. It's the power that's in Christ. And when you have Christ living in you. And that's a good thing. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So, part of what helped me, and we'll kind of keep things very Christ-focused. Then we'll start going through some of the doctrines and the scriptures and stuff like that. But to me, Christ is my doctrine. Amen?
Amen.
And so Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Now, did Jesus ever say some of the things that we say about sickness and disease? For example, you know, Peter was pretty much a numbskull, right? Did Jesus ever say, you know what, Peter? That's the last time. You know, buddy, you've contradicted me. You've shown off in front of these other guys. Here's a little tuberculosis until you figure this out. He didn't give him some disease to help him learn spiritual lessons and develop character, did he? He didn't do that. Did he, when he walked into a village, oftentimes it says that he healed all, right? Every time it talked about how many he healed. He healed all who had need of healing. He just indiscriminately healed. Now there's a few places when Jesus was in Jerusalem, he could not take that approach. It was just a constraint because half the people wanted to force him to be king. The other half wanted to kill him on the spot, right? So he had to keep moving, right? Remember the guy in the pool of Siloam? You read that story. Jesus didn't go wander and say, eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Today's your lucky day. You guys are all screwed. Sorry. It wasn't like that. It said as soon as he saw him, he went to him. He asked him about his condition. He healed him. But because of the crowds, he had to leave. Boom, he left. He couldn't just stay around like he could in the villages. But every time he had his leisure and had his way, he just healed them all. Boom, 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 boom. Some of you are thinking, well, what about his hometown? Right? That's one I get all the time. It's in here somewhere. I'm going to try to find it so we can look exactly at that one. Let's see here. Page 33. I want you to see. I know it by heart. Page 41 in the manual if you got one. But I'll call out the scripture references for those of you that don't. Matthew chapter 13 verses 53 to 58 is where it's in Matthew's account. Mark chapter 6, verses 1 to 6 is Mark's account. Okay? So a lot of times people say even Jesus couldn't get everyone healed because it says that, you know, when he went to his own town, he couldn't heal many people because of their unbelief. Let's read it. And it came to pass, this is Matthew's version, chapter 13, verse 53, starting at verse 53. And it came to pass when Jesus had finished these parables, he departed from thence. Then he came to his own country. He taught them in the synagogue. They were astonished. They said, where does this man have this wisdom and these mighty works? Okay, so they've been seeing something apparently. Is this not the carpenter's son? Mary is called mother. We know all his brothers. We know his sisters. They're with us. Where does he have all these things? And verse 57 says this, and they were offended at him. But Jesus said unto him, a prophet is not without honor save in his own country and in his own house. And listen to this, verse 58, and he did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Why don't you say this with me? Many mighty works.
Many mighty works.
Many mighty works.
Many.
Didn't say that he didn't do any mighty works. Says he didn't do many mighty works. Why? Because of their unbelief. The verse right before describes the unbelief. They were offended at him. Now, how many of y'all been married? That's my best context for being offended. Because I'll tell you what, I have offended my wife once or twice. Mm-hmm. All right? Don't touch me. Don't talk to me right now. You know, it can be that way, right? When somebody's offended, man, that's it. They don't want to be touched. They don't want to be talked to. Nothing, you know. But you know, they just need some time, right? I just need some time. Little funny thing. This isn't really that funny. My wife, in every relationship, there's usually one person in the conflict that is bent on resolving that conflict and want to speak about it. And they pursue. And the other person, their tendency is, I want to run away. I just don't want to deal with it. I just want to talk about it. Well, I am the pursuer. I want to get this done. Let's just talk about it. Let's get this over with. My wife, she wanted to, you know, I don't want to talk about this. Time will heal all wounds, you know. Just forget about it. We won't talk about it. We won't solve anything. We'll just feel better eventually. I know that don't work either, right? So she locked herself in the bathroom. This is early, early in our marriage. I sat in the living room chair. It did not make me feel good. Because I, at that time, was taking that very personally. I felt like that meant she didn't, you know, I was feeling rejected and it's all about me. She came out of the bathroom and I said, if I'm not allowed to beat you, you are not allowed to lock yourself in that bathroom anymore. Don't worry, I don't beat my wife. Never wanted to. We got past that. We learned how to argue well. That's a good thing for marriage. You got to learn how to disagree well. Learn how to work through your problems and talk about it. Okay. A little bit of insight into my life. So they were offended at him. They did not want them. So Jesus wasn't able to do many mighty works there. You go look at Mark chapter 6 and you get a little bit more information. In verse 5 it says, and he could do there no mighty works save that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. Amen? So even on a bad day, Jesus healed everybody he laid his hands on. What made it so that he wasn't able to do many mighty works there is that they took offense because Jesus laid his hands. A few people, they saw this. They got healed. Where does he have these powers from? Jesus starts explaining to them, this verse is fulfilled in your hearing. I'm the Messiah. And they're like, you got to be kidding me. You're not... And that's it. No more healing ministry. Jesus marveled at their unbelief that they would rather be offended at him having seen people get healed, but they would rather their people stay sick, stay hurting, than to allow him to minister to them. They were that offended. And so he marveled at that. And you want to know how offended they were? I think it's in Luke chapter 6 where you find out that it was a different visit, but these same people were the ones that tried to throw him off a cliff. Remember? I mean, they were there. I mean, they were enraged at him. Okay? So this was either, I think this was a different visit than that one. But these are the same people. So you can see the mindsets. I mean, this was deep offense. All right? What am I saying that for? The neat thing about it is that when you look carefully at the Scriptures, what you'll find is that a lot of what you've been taught about why God might not heal, why God doesn't always want to heal, why God sometimes is on the side of sickness, you will find if you look closely at those Scriptures, they don't hold up. And it's good news for us because it shows us God is for our healing, that Jesus Christ is the same, that He's with us and He's in us. And when we start renewing our mind to the Word of God, we start believing more like Christ. Amen? And you start realizing we don't have to get something from God. We have received for something from God. Amen? We're not trying to get God to open up heaven to give us healing. Because you haven't given us. He's put Christ inside of us. Healing's in Him. Amen?
Amen.
So silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to you. Now how did Jesus deal with sickness? Oh Father, please come and touch him. Let's find out what God wants to do. No, He knew. He said, I've seen my Father. And I only do what I see Him doing. Apparently, Jesus never saw His Father asking someone else to heal sickness. So He said, the Son does it in like manner. Why? Because we're made to bear the Father's image. And we follow Jesus, don't we? When we are His disciples, He's training us up to be just like Him. Amen? And so that's God's vision for us. He's made us children of God. We need to learn to walk like children of God. So when we minister to the sick, I don't ask God to come and heal them. I know that God has sent Jesus Christ and He has brought and released healing on the face of the planet Earth. And He's put that healing inside of me. And He's made me a son. So the same way Jesus said, I can't do anything apart from my Father, but you never see Jesus asking God, please come and touch him. He always spoke with authority to sickness, didn't He? He always acted with authority over sickness. Guess what? We act in His authority. We speak in His name. We're ambassadors of Jesus Christ. That's why it says, silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give to Thee. Oh, Father, please come and touch him now. Please, right now. He doesn't do that, does he? He says, in the name of Jesus, rise, walk. Amen?
Amen.
Where you see people, Jesus said, if you have faith, you will say to the mountain. We don't speak to God about mountains. We speak to mountains in the name of Jesus Christ. And the power of God is released through the words that we say. Amen? That's a neat thing. That's Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, somewhere in there. 6. Man knows his word. Let me see here. Let's check to see if we're right. Where we at? Matthew. Somewhere in there. 20. Okay. All right. So we got the right chapter. All right. So here's what we're going to do now. Let's take a little bit of a break. I think Pastor, somebody was going to receive an offering for this evening. And then we're going, before we go home, we're going to have some activation time. Sounds good? Okay. Yeah, so let me pause it here. The way that we do the conferences, we make those free, available. So if you're here tonight, and this is a gift to you. We love for you to be here, so don't feel compelled or obligated to do anything. This is an opportunity for you not to sow into your healing. This isn't because Jesus paid for your healing by His blood. This has nothing to do with that. What this has to do with is your opportunity to give and receive in the body of Christ. You're receiving the ministry. This is an opportunity for you to give so that others down the road can continue to receive this ministry. So I appreciate that. My family appreciates eating, all those kinds of things. God takes good care of us, and so we're really excited. You seek first the kingdom. Kingdom takes care of you. So we're excited. The other thing, just want to let you know, is that tomorrow, when we come to the miracle service that is on Saturday night at 7 o'clock, be inviting your friends for that. At that service, we will not receive any offering at all. So you just tell them, you leave your wallets at home, because oftentimes the ministry of healing has been so closely associated with, hey, you know, you line my pocket and then I'll pray for your healing kind of stuff. We don't do those shenanigans. So this is an opportunity that as we're teaching, we feel like that it's an that you can understand that better. So we don't feel bad about saying, hey, this is an opportunity for you to give so that others can also receive this down the line. All right, so I'm going to let story. There were three guys that walked past, and so I did the hard stuff, right? I approached them and said, hey, guys, you want to see something cool? And they were younger guys, and they were like, sure, right? And then I said, which of you has like pain, something like an injury or something in your body doesn't work right or hurts? And they all started to look to one guy, you know, and then he said, I have bad back pain. And I said, really? So you feel it now? And he goes, yeah. I said, well, my friend here, he travels around the world and God uses him for miracles. He didn't know that this was the first time that this guy's really done this, but it's true. He travels around the world. And I know my Bible says God uses him for miracles. Amen. And so so I said, you should let him pray for your back. And so my friend, which is Isabel's husband, put his hands on his back and said, right now in the name of Jesus, all pain come out of this back. You be healed now. And so I said, okay, now move around. And he goes, he started cussing. he's like, it's gone. And then he started feeling around. He goes like, no, serious. I was born with scoliosis. And he said, it's even straight. And I had just come back from Florida riding in the car and my back was so hurting, it was swelling. And the swelling's gone and my back is straight. And that was like really cool. And so then I said, what about the rest of you? There's two others. One guy says, well, my legs hurt. And he goes, really? I said, what's wrong with him? He goes, well, I just worked out yesterday. Right? So he's just, you know, he's sore from leg day. And right away, your mind starts getting in there like, you know, I wonder if God even wants to heal something like this. Does God love him?
Yes.
Can God heal him?
Yes.
All right, so why don't we just step up? Because Jesus said, you know, if you believe, nothing will be impossible for you. Amen? So he laid his hands on his legs and said, right now in Jesus' name, all pain out of these legs, be healed. And I said, all right, now move. And he goes, oh, man, you got to be kidding me. That's, how do you do that? And said, you want to know how this works? And he goes, they go, yeah. And he goes, it's Jesus. You know, it's so easy to explain the gospel when you have people tell us, yeah, when Jesus really is who he said he was, that he lived, God came to live among us, that he died for us, that he rose again so that he could forgive our sins, and that when you believe in him, he comes to live in you. And he healed you because he loves you. And what he did in your bodies, he can do in your whole life. Do you guys know Jesus? No, we don't know him. Would you like to know him? Yeah, we want to know him. It's really simple. You just need to call on him, ask him to forgive you, and begin to follow him. And so, do you guys have Bibles? No, we don't have Bibles. I've got a Bible. Okay, the rest of you need to get Bibles. Start reading the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, any of them. And start, you know, find a church that believes the Bible and believes in the Holy Spirit. I usually tell people both of those, right? So it was a good time, amen? But it wasn't that complicated. So this is what we're going to do now. What I'd like everybody to do, this is the hardest part, I find. All right, so this is going to be hard. I want everybody to stand up. Now, I want everybody to walk around this room, and I want you to find somebody that you don't know very well if you can. Just find somebody. Okay, don't be shy. If you see somebody that looks shy that you don't know very well, then you go find them. Don't worry. All right. Is there anybody that does not yet have a partner? Please put your hand straight up in the air. You're going over there? All right. Okay, we got. Is there anyone that does not have a partner yet? Please raise your hand. You have. Okay, everybody's got a partner? Yes? All right, very good. Now, this is what we're going to do. Before we do anything, I want everybody to hold your hand out in front of you. All right? We're going to speak to our hands. Right? I want you to repeat after me. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
This is not my hand.
This is not my hand.
This hand belongs to Jesus Christ.
This hand belongs to Jesus Christ.
I am a member of the body of Christ.
I am a member of the body of Christ.
The power of God flows through this hand.
The power of God flows through this hand.
When I lay hands on the sick.
When I lay hands on the sick.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Jesus lays hands on the sick.
Jesus lays hands on the sick.
Sickness must go.
Sickness must go.
Devils go.
Devils go.
Bodies are healed.
Bodies are healed.
Because the kingdom of God is at hand.
Because the kingdom of God is at hand.
In this hand.
In this hand.
Amen?
Amen.
All right. Now, I want you guys, if you're kind of all clumped together, if you can kind of get to where everybody's nice and comfortable, not stepping on one another's toes or nothing. All right, now, this is what we're going to do. We're going to practice ministering healing one to another. All right, so the one who is the tallest gets to be Jesus first. All right, if you can't figure out who is the tallest, then go with the one with the longest hair. All right, because Jesus was tall and had long hair, in my mind, right? All right, he might have been short and had short hair for all I know, but that's my thinking, all right? So does everybody know who's going first? All right, okay. Now, this is what we're going to do. If you are the one who is receiving ministry first, not the one who's giving, Jesus, you know, the tall one with the long hair, If you're not that person, if you're the short one with short hair, you're going to be receiving ministry first. So if you have anything that needs to be healed, I want you to tell your partner very briefly what it is that needs to be healed. I want you to tell them a body part. I don't want you to tell or a very simple disease name. Don't give us Latin terms. We are not doctors. Okay? And I do not want you giving them a medical history. And I don't want you telling them how long I've had it and how many people have prayed for it and it still hasn't. None of that is relevant. None of it. Because Jesus is Lord. Amen? And He has the right and the power and the authority to heal you right now. Amen? So, if you can do that, if you're Jesus, just say, introduce yourself. Don't introduce yourself. Say, hey, my name is, and give them your real name. I'm not, and then just say, do you have anything that needs to be healed? And then if you need something healed, then you tell them. If you don't need anything healed, you came here tonight and there's nothing gives you any aches or pains, nothing that you could even tell that there was a miracle in your body, make something up. They will not even know the difference. They're going to practice on you, okay? All right. So for all you know, you're believing God and you don't even know if it's real or not, because you know what? To God, it doesn't matter. It's not big to Him. Amen. So this gets to be fun. You're going to see God do some awesome things. So let's take about 30 seconds. Shouldn't take that long. And then after that, I just want you to stop and I'm going to lead you through the next step. We're going to do this orderly, one after the other. I'm going to hold your hand through the whole process. I do not want anyone to start right away, start praying and doing your own thing. We're going to walk through this step by step by step, okay? So after you've had that little conversation, just stop and look at me and I'll take us on to the next day, okay? Well, any questions?
What's the part that we're doing first?
The first part?
Do you have any?
Yep, just tell them your names and introduce yourself and say, do you have anything that needs to be healed? And then he's going to tell you what needs to be healed. Okay. Okay. Wade, you and Pastor can partner up if you want. Okay, very good. Should be a short conversation because you don't have that many body parts. If it hurts all over, just say I have lots of aches and pains in different places. All right. Now, this is what I want you to do. If you are the one who's giving the ministry, I want you to go ahead and just take them by the hand like a handshake. Or if it's a very easy body part to get to, like a shoulder or a knee or something like that, that's not anywhere in the private areas. You know, like if they got prostate cancer, and I want you, if they got, a lump in their breast they don't know about, you just take their hand. You don't have to touch the affected area, but if it's something like a shoulder or an elbow or something real easy to get to, you can do it that way. Otherwise, just take them by the hand. All right? Just go ahead and do that. Okay. Now, we're going to do this together, and I want you to do this. When you're speaking, you are speaking in the name and the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen? And you're believing that the power of God's flowing through you to them. So I want you to say this. We're going to say it together, okay? You ready? All right. In the name of Jesus,
in the name of Jesus,
and the power of the Holy Spirit,
be healed.
All pain, go.
Sickness, go.
Bodies, be healed.
In
Jesus' name. Now just believe for the power of God to flow into them. Take your hand off. Now, if you receive ministry, I want you to check yourself. Do something you couldn't do before. If something caused you pain, I want you to do it. Okay? Now, how many of you checked yourself? How many of you experienced there's definite change? Okay, look around the room. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, any complete 100%? It's gone. I don't feel anything right now. 1, 2, praise the Lord. Two instant miracles, amen? And several others that experienced definite change. You're not just doing this to make me feel good, right? Amen. Wait, what'd you... Sore feet from standing all day, pain left instantly. Praise the Lord. How about you, ma'am?
Pressure on my head and it's free and tingly.
All right, very good. Okay, now others of you experienced definite change, but it's not all the way gone. Others of you didn't notice maybe any change. So what do you do in those situations?
Pray again.
Same thing you did last time. You don't, well, what do I? How do I pray differently? You don't get up into your mind, you believe Jesus. Just like you did last time. Last time you released the power of the kingdom, and it's working. Amen? Now you're going to release some more. Amen? You hit it again. Amen? So let's just do this. Same people that were doing the ministry, you're going to do it again. I'm going to walk you right through it. We're going to do it together, right? In the name of Jesus, I take authority over this sickness and pain. You go! Come out. Be healed. In Jesus' name. Now believe for the power of God to touch them. Take your hands off. Do something you couldn't do. Test yourself. Check yourself out. Okay. How are we doing? How many of you did experience some change are 100% now? 1, 2. What happened?
I've had knee pain for a year and a half.
Really? Wow. It's gone.
And I can't feel it anymore.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. How about you, little miss? Praise the Lord. Amen. Okay, good. Good. All right, good. We're going to hit it one more time. Now this time, you know how I did it, okay? I want you to say just what you did last time. I want you to take authority over it. And here's the thing, okay? You don't have to be loud, but I want you to be earnest. Amen. You are not praying. You know, sometimes people have this tendency, they have nice little sweet prayers with Jesus. You need to tap into your inner Rambo. Right? You see what I mean? It's the mama bear. You've got somebody who's picking on one of your friends who's a bully. Right? You can't appeal to their kindness. Oh, please go. No, this is you go. Amen? So you're telling this, you tell the bad stuff to leave, sickness, pain, whatever they've got going on, and you tell the body to be healed and then believe for God to move that mountain, that you're speaking to it, you're believing that God's going to bring it what you say to pass. Amen? That's how Holy Spirit works. God said, let there be light. Boom, then Holy Spirit sprung into action. Amen? He waits for the word. All right, so you do it just like I did it. All right, but I'm not going to lead you this time. I want you to get used to doing it on your own. No training wheels. All right?
Oh, yeah?